I'm Minh Hun, and you're listening to the U Chicago Public Policy Podcast.
Welcome to the University of Chicago Public Policy Podcasts. This is UC3P, our eponymously named podcast on policy, politics, and current affairs. My name is David Raban, and I'm the production manager for what we like to call the main page. Today, we're releasing two episodes. The earlier one is a continuation of our special coverage of how Harris students are doing while sheltering in place. In this episode, we begin our substantive interviews on COVID-19. Today's guest is Dr. Joshua Epstein, a professor of epidemiology at New York University. He's also the director of NYU's agent-based modeling lab, where he researches both viruses and the fear surrounding them. We talk to him about social distancing, immunity, and how to avoid a second outbreak. Before we get into the interview, a few notes. First, we want to remind you that we no longer have access to our studio, so our sound quality won't be the same as before. Second, we recorded this interview on April 15, so bear with us as things are changing really quickly. Finally, we'll have more episodes coming up on the coronavirus, so make sure to check in for those. Now, let's get straight into the interview. Without further ado, here's NYU Professor of Epidemiology, Joshua Epstein.
Welcome to UC3P, the University of Chicago Public Policy Podcasts. My name is Sidhant Wadhera, and today we have the pleasure of speaking with Joshua Epstein, who is a professor of epidemiology at New York University. Dr. Epstein, thank you so much for joining us today.
Pleasure to be here.
Before we get into it, we just want to note for our audience that things are moving really fast. We're recording this on Wednesday, April 15th. At this point, over 25,000 people in the United States have passed away. Many of us have been sheltering in place for more than a month. The country is clearly facing a trifecta of a viral threat, a lack of capacity in the healthcare system, and an economic collapse. I think it's fair to say that there's a general feeling of heightened anxiety in our everyday lives. So, with all that background out of the way, we want to start our discussion with two simple questions. In terms of the viral threat, what is happening right now, and what is going to happen next?
Thank you for the nice introduction. Of course, where are we now? It depends on where you are. I think in a place like New York, where I am, we are hopeful that we're at the peak of the epidemic, but that needs to be understood carefully. Most epidemics are symmetrical. If you look at these curves with the flattening the curve and the high curve and those things, they're kind of bell-shaped curves. They're one humped, they go up and then they go down, but the peak is actually about halfway through the epidemic. So almost half the cases are probably ahead of us. So while, yes, it's good that new cases are leveling off and new cases are falling, a lot of total of the epidemic is ahead of us, perhaps as much as a half. Now, if you flatten the curve, as it were, then you may end up with the same number of cases in the end, but they're coming at you at a different pace and one you might be able to handle a lot better than when the disease was exploding. And this, the reason for this is that the peak, if you flatten it out, could be lower, so that the emergency demand on hospitals and healthcare systems is lower. Handling a giant spike, the spike just completely overwhelms the system, and these lower peaks would be easier to handle, and cases would be coming in at a lower rate, and testing might be out there, and it might be a much more manageable situation if we get testing into the field and so forth. We can come back to that. But the main point about the peak is, you know, you can't just breathe a sigh of relief and say, ah, good, we made it to the peak, we're out of the woods. You're in the middle of the woods at the peak. Now, when you say, where are we? That depends on where you are in the country. I mean, in the United States, New York is New York is the epicenter, followed by a few other large cities. Smaller places may get through this, you know, more quickly. But I think the main thing in finding out where we are is to get testing out there. Just don't have enough testing to know in some of the country, in a lot of the country, whether the disease is on the rise, whether we're at the peak, whether we're past the peak, and so forth.
The second question was, what is going to happen next?
Okay, well, I mean, this depends heavily on policy and on behavior. A couple things could happen next. For those who study the history of these things, the Spanish flu, the 1918 flu that killed perhaps 50 million people worldwide, in all the major cities, or many of the major cities of the United States, we saw two epidemic waves. The first wave came, people responded with social distancing, and the distancing reduced the spread rate. And the disease started to decline and decline and decline until it was at a very low level. Prevalence was at quite a low level. And people thought, okay, you know, we're practically out of the woods. Let's relax all the distancing. The trouble is, epidemics are explosive, nonlinear systems. And if you have even a few infectives out there and you pour the gasoline of susceptible people onto the infectives, it reignites. And that's what happened in 1918 in New York and Chicago and other major cities here. And it can happen again in COVID. If we relax distancing while there's still a lot of infection out there, we'll get a second wave. And, you know, it could be as bad as the first wave. It's just reckless to reopen everything until we really have a fix on the state of the epidemic nationwide, and certainly in places like New York City.
If through testing, we find out that people have had the virus and have recovered, can those people go back into society without spreading the virus? Or is it just too soon for us to know?
Immune people might be able to go back to work safely. And this is the importance of the so-called antibody test. You hear a lot about testing, but there's really two kinds of tests. One test is just a test for the virus. Are you sick? Another is a test for antibodies. And that tells, have you been sick? And do you now have some immunity to reinfection? And the wide assumption in the expert community is that for this particular virus, if you've had it, you are going to be immune for some time. Dr. Fauci says, you know, it could be months or longer, but he believes if you've had this disease and survived it, you have real immunity and lasting immunity. There may be departures from that, but I think by and large, everyone thinks if you've had the disease and we have an antibody test to prove it, then you could safely go back to work, or you could back up the healthcare workforce in dealing with this problem. You could move patients, you could do all kinds of facilities and transportation and lots of other things to back them up, or you could also just go back to your normal occupation if that were feasible. And we also are encouraged, having found that the virus isn't mutating rapidly, isn't mutating, you know, appreciably. And so once you're immune to this virus, it's not likely to wiggle off into some other virus that you're not immune to. That's called antigenic drift. And it's a type of mutation that we're not seeing in the COVID-19 virus.
Is this virus like the chickenpox where you can only get it once? Or is it more like the flu where we would need to rebuild immunity every year?
Again, you know, it's a new virus. We don't know everything we'd like to know biomedically. But we again, because of the stability of the virus, we feel that if you have immunity, it should be relatively long-lasting. But on the other hand, now, so you don't want to have chickenpox parties and things like this. And if we're paying people to go back to work who are immune, some people might say, well, let's just get the damn thing, get over it, and then we can go back to work. That's very ill-advised. It kills people in every age group. We really don't want to see people getting the disease in order to go back to work.
So some researchers think that this virus could die out like SARS or MERS. What does it actually mean for a virus to die out? And how likely do you think that is to happen with COVID-19?
Well, what it would mean is that the thing's literally eradicated from the biosphere. That's very unlikely, partly because it will probably remain circulating in humans at some low level, and it may turn out to be a seasonal epidemic on that grounds. But more to the point, it probably came from an animal reservoir like bats, and it's not going to be eradicated from that population and can always jump back into the human one.
You've been listening to our conversation with Dr. Joshua Epstein, professor of epidemiology at New York University. We'll be right back in a moment to discuss fear, vaccines, and immunity. Stay close.
Hey, UC3P listeners. I'm Thomas.
And I'm Nick.
In the United States, public faith in the military remains sky high, while trust in other government institutions sinks to an all-time low.
At the same time, fewer than 1% of Americans will ever serve in the armed forces, and the cultural divide between active duty troops and the civilian population continues to widen.
UC3P presents a new series, Thank You for Your Service, where we take a deep dive into the complex world of civil-military affairs.
We'll address the politicization of the military, defense policy in the news, and the importance of staying informed in a democracy.
Join us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts as we explore how our professional military institution relates to the society it serves.
And we're back with Dr. Joshua Epstein. In addition to being a professor of epidemiology, he's also the director of NYU's Agent-Based Modeling Lab. Dr. Epstein, at your lab, you model viruses, but you also model fear. Most people aren't aware of what that means in the context of pandemics. Please describe to our audience what fear means in your research and what your models say about it.
It's a big part of our work, sir. I'm the director of the Agent-Based Modeling Laboratory at NYU. And yeah, we try to model fear, the contagion of fear, and build software agents who are able to acquire fear the way we observe its acquisition in humans and mammals. And we try to use the neuroscience of fear, the cognitive neuroscience of fear, which includes neuroimaging and other methods, to understand how people acquire fears and how fears can evaporate if you take away the aversive stimulus. And my most recent agent is a creature named Agent Zero, which is meant to be an improvement on the sort of rational actor of economics, where the agent is perfectly rational, perfectly well-informed, makes, you know, optimal decisions and considers all the options and the rest. And my agent, Agent Zero, he has a deliberative capacity, but there's also an emotional component that can override rational deliberations. And fear is a very good candidate for the emotional component because we know a lot about it. And we even have very simple but revealing equations that we can put into Agent Zero so that when they're in a situation where there's an aversive stimulus and, you know, they can acquire fear of it, and it's not really a choice to be afraid. It's just part of our neural architecture that we acquire these fears. And we can actually give them to other people. You can transmit fear. And there's also neuroscience about that. And the point is, we have models of infectious disease where there's one contagion of disease, but there's also contagion of fear about the disease. And when the fear spreads, people can take action like self-isolation, get out of circulation, and so forth. That depresses the disease. But then using these same equations, fear evaporates, they come out of the basement, and you get the second wave. So one of the ways we're trying to understand second waves and other things is by including this emotional behavioral component in the modeling. And the same modeling applies to financial panics, vaccine refusal, and a lot of the other concurrent diseases we're confronting these days. There's a disease of COVID-19, but there's also contagion of financial panic, of fear of the disease. There'll be a fear of the vaccine. We have to cope with several fears. And I think, although our models are very, you know, simple, early, provisional, they try to get our teeth into this phenomenon, which I think is central to many phenomena in the social sciences generally.
So sort of building on that conversation about fear, you talk about vaccines a little bit in your previous response. How do you think fear of vaccines is going to compound with the fear in your model that you've been discussing?
Yeah, I mean, we have a new model that has fear of disease and fear of vaccine. And the way it works in that model, and